Welcome to the 15th meeting of 2023 in Session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. We have received apologies from Pam Gosell. Agenda item 1 is agreement to consider evidence in private. Our first agenda item is to agree to take item 6, which is consideration of today's evidence in private. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. The second agenda item is affirmative subordinate legislation and its consideration of the affirmative instrument. The draft first-tier Tribunal for Scotland, Local Taxation, Chamber and Upper Tribunal for Scotland, Composition and Procedure, Miscellaneous Amendment Regulations 2023. I welcome to the meeting Siobhan Brown, MSP, Minister for Victims, Community Safety and her supporting officials, Lisa Davidson, Senior Policy Officer, Civil Courts and Tribunals, and Leanne McLarty, Solicitor, Scottish Government Legal Directorate. And I refer members to Paper 1. I'd like to invite the Minister to speak to the draft instrument.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Committee. The regulations before you are the First Tier Tribunal for Scotland Local Taxation Chamber and Upper Tribunal for Scotland Composition and Procedure Miscellaneous Amendment Regulations 2023. This instrument will, if passed, amend the First Tier Tribunal for Scotland Local Taxation Chamber and Upper Tribunal for Scotland Composition Regulations 2023, the Council Tax Alteration of Lists and Appeal Scotland Regulations 1993, and the Council Tax Reduction Scotland Regulations 2021. A suite of regulations to affect the transfer of functions of the Council Tax Reduction Review Panel and the Valuation Appeal Committees to the Local Taxation Chamber of the First Tier Tribunal came into force on the 1st of April 2023. At the same time, some limited functions of the Lands Tribunal for Scotland were transferred to the Upper Tribunal. The Lands Tribunal functions, which transferred related to non-domestic rates valuation appeals and referrals, and prior to the transfer of functions, these appeals or referrals were from the Valuation Appeals Committees. These regulations amend the composition of the Upper Tribunal when hearing appeals or referrals from the Local Taxation Chamber. The regulations align the composition of the Upper Tribunal when hearing valuation rating appeals with the composition of the Upper Tribunal when hearing all other appeals. The regulations also amend the timescales set out in the Council Tax Alteration of Lists and Appeals Scotland Regulations Act 1993. And prior to the transfer of functions, an assessor had a period of 6 months to carry out certain functions when they were of the opinion that a proposed alteration of a council tax valuation ban was not well founded. This was substituted in transfer regulations to a time period of 6 weeks. Following representation from stakeholders, there are concerns that this time frame is overambitious and these regulations will amend it back to the 6 months. These regulations also correct a consequential amendment in Regulation 94 of the Council Tax Reduction Regulations 2021. The President of the Scottish Tribunals was consulted with regard to these regulations in line with the requirements of the Tribunals Scotland Act 2014, and I understand that the DPLRC considered these regulations on the 30th of May and they were content with the instrument. I'm happy to answer any questions, Convener.
Thank you. Any questions? No questions. So are we agreed? Sorry, I've sort of... yes, thank you. So, since no member of the committee has indicated that they wish to ask any questions or make any comments, we'll move straight to agenda item 3, which is the formal business in relation to the instrument. So I invite the Minister to move the motion.
Move, Convener.
Thank you. Do members have any other final comments? No. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. So I invite the committee to agree to delegate to me the publication of a short factual report on our deliberations on the affirmative SSI that we have considered today. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. That completes consideration of the affirmative instrument. I thank the Minister and her officials for attending, and we'll pause just very, very briefly, and then we'll move straight on to the next one. We'll now move on to agenda item 4, which is consideration of one negative Scottish statutory instrument. That's the SSI 2023-165. The Act of Sederunt Fees of Solicitors in the Court of Session, Sheriff Appeal Court and Sheriff Court Taxation of Judicial Expenses, Rules Amendment 2023. And I refer members to paper 2. So do members have any comments to make on that instrument?
Yes. Can I just make a point here in the charges? It's quite... the cost recovery factors, which it, within the charges, the council had approved a 9.75 inflationary increase to aspects of all tables of fees, but at the end of the papers that we received, it said that in arriving at the increase to the charge rate, the council anticipates there will be considerable volatility in consumer-based indices over the next few years, and that CPI are unlikely to be unreliable measures after September 2021. I didn't quite understand why we were looking at why it was those dates were relevant in the rules provision, but I just want to put it on record that I don't quite get it.
What is it that you wish it's for just, us to record it just on seems record?
That there's considerable volatility in consumer-based indices based on this, the approval of the table of fees set out in Schedule 1. I don't think there's anything we can do. I just want to put it on record.
Okay. If you have a concern, I can advise you that you do have the ability to lodge a motion to annul with the Chamber desk, and then the issue will be discussed and debated in the Chamber. Our timetable doesn't allow for us to discuss it again, but that is a route that is available to you should you wish to take it.
That's very generous, Convener, but I won't be doing that today. It's just on record.
Okay. Thank you very much. So in that case, and bearing in mind what Rachel Hamilton has said, are the members content formally not to make any comments to Parliament on these issues?
Yeah.
I think we're all, are we agreed? Did I get a nod of the head from Paul? Yeah, I did. Lovely. That concludes the consideration of the SSI. Thank you. And I'd like to suspend briefly before we move on to the next session. Good morning. Our next item of business is conclusion of evidence on our inquiry on asylum seekers in Scotland. It is in fact World Refugee Day today, so it is possibly a good day for us to come to the conclusion of our inquiry. The first panel, I would like to welcome Baroness Helena Kennedy KC, Chair of the Independent Commission of Inquiry into Asylum Provision in Scotland, who is joining us remotely today. Good morning and welcome, Baroness.
Good morning, Chair, and thank you very much for inviting me to this session.
Thank you. I would like to invite Baroness Kennedy to make a brief opening statement, and this will be followed by questions from members of the committee. Baroness?
Let me explain how I came to be the Independent Commissioner dealing with asylum issues in Scotland. I was invited to do this. First of all, it was thought that the Royal Society of Edinburgh might have been hosting this commission. Some difficulties arose around that because inevitably there was going to have to be very substantial criticism of the powers that be that were responsible for some things that had gone wrong. And so the refugee organisation that was calling for this inquiry settled on there being an independent commission, and it was funded by the Rowntree Foundation. I was invited by both entities to be the person who might chair this, and I did so and came up to Glasgow, but also held a number of sessions virtually like we're doing today. It was a shocking business, and it arose out of COVID and the early period of lockdown, which of course affected all of us. But for the community of people who are awaiting asylum resolution and decisions on their asylum applications, who were in Glasgow, it had particular implications. What had happened was that many of them had already been settled into accommodation, flats that had once been council flats, other kinds of accommodation, housing associations, some of it private rental accommodation, but they were mainly settled in accommodation and had been, some of them, for several years. And suddenly, on a particular day, and over a very short period of time, the doors were knocked and they were told to pack their bags and that they were being taken to different accommodation because of the pandemic. And they were told to leave their food behind in their fridges, even if they were cooking on the stove, everything had to be left of that sort. There was no food to be allowed into hotels. And they were moved into hotels in the centre of Glasgow. And then many of you will remember the events that took place, where people clearly had mental health responses to this. I mean, people who have fled persecution and who are applying for asylum in our country almost invariably are being supported by the health services. And they had got to know local clinics, local doctors, local social workers, and of course, being moved disrupted all of that. And there were people who had serious mental health problems. Someone committed suicide, and a particular individual had a psychotic episode where he ran around with a knife in the hotel, attacked a number of people, including a police officer who arrived to deal with the emergency, and eventually a SWAT team arrived and he was shot dead by the police. Now, there was a strong feeling that while no one was feeling that there had been many alternatives to what the ending was with regard to that particular person, what was felt strongly was that taking people into hotels at short notice and taking them away from places where they'd established connection with neighbours, with health services and so on, had in fact led to a crisis. And so my role was to hold an inquiry into that and to provide a report on it. And of course, we've got to remember that most of this emanated from decisions made by the Home Office, because this is a non-devolved matter.
Thank you. Thank you, Baroness. Many of the findings of the asylum inquiry resonate with the evidence heard by our committee, such as people not feeling safe in the hotels, the food being inadequate, relying on charities, barriers to accessing healthcare, including mental healthcare. And it also reflects on similar inconsistent evidence provided by MERS and the third sector organisations. The third sector has been quite critical of MERS, while local authorities have said that they work well with MERS. And MERS have said that they work well with all partners associated with asylum accommodation. Do you think that there is inconsistency in evidence between private contractors and third sector organisations? And I would also be interested to hear your views on the use of private contractors in this context.
The evidence that we received in relation to MERS was what did involve a high level of criticism of them and the way that they handled these events. One of the things that we discovered was that the people who were given the task of going and respond to call-outs and things like that by, for example, the hotels, would find that the people who came had been given new nomenclatures. They were given new names, titles on their badge, you know, where they were called, welfare officers, when the week before they were called housing, managers. And instead of, doing the thing of looking at things that had gone wrong, like the boiler or the lighting system, suddenly they were expected to deal with things, issues like mental health, which they were not equipped to do. So we felt that there was just giving somebody a different name doesn't lead to the kind of sort of support that people need in these circumstances. So I did think that there was an inadequacy and that came through very strongly in the evidence we heard. The local authorities might say that their dealings with MERS are perfectly fine. They're not, of course, the people who are at the receiving end, who are the asylum seekers, mm-hmm. and the people who've got mental health problems. Now, there's as well as MERS, you have to remember, this is subcontracted to MERS, a national company, a UK-wide company, not a company confined to Scotland. It's a subcontraction from the Home Office. I feel that when it comes to matters of this sort, I would prefer it was a not-for-profit organisation. MERS made a lot of money over the COVID crisis, as many other organisations did out of the privatisation of certain kinds of aspects of our existence. And I do not feel that profit making in this area is a good thing. If you looked at the sums and you looked at what was the money that was made at this time, I think it would be a shock to our system. The other thing was that there was a helpline called the Migrant Helpline, and I asked the woman who was a sort of counsel to the inquiry. I said, I want to see how this runs, because many of the people complained about the fact that they would try to phone the helpline and they would be hanging on the phone for hours. These are people who are, they have a phone that has got a card, these are not people who can afford to be hanging on a line forever. But if you're in a distressed situation, it's pretty hard going. And the woman who was working to me, was on it for hours waiting. It should be told, you are now 65th in the queue. Because it was a nationwide thing based at the headquarters of it are based in Brighton. I don't know where the call centre is. But the call centre was very low in... turn this off. The call centre was very poor in its response to people who were in crisis, who were wanting help. And we asked them to provide us with, they said, that, but we did respond to calls in Glasgow and so on. And so we said, well, can you give us the record of how many people called and what your responses were? It was never forthcoming. So I felt that the migrant helpline was inadequate, and that's another privatised thing. And I felt that the outsourcing to MERS had serious shortcomings. So that was the view that I took. And now I do think you know, and I'm affected by other areas of my life where I'm dealing with the human rights and the protections of the rights of different groupings. We know that, for example, the privatisation of the care system for children has been a catastrophe. The privatisation of, for example, in England and Wales of the probation service has been really wholly unsuccessful. There are some areas of our life where outsourcing to profit-making companies is just not, I think, an appropriate or ethical thing to do when you're dealing with humanity in crisis.
Thank you for that. That seems to be a sort of question around the moral efficacy of private sort of contractors dealing with the situation of asylum seekers, people in such distress.
Well, it's not. It's more than moral. It's more than, Ms. Stewart, it's more than moral. You see, of course there are moral and ethical issues about our responsibility to those to whom we might have a duty of care. But there's another thing here, which is that if you are having to determine, make decisions where your primary concern is going to be safeguarding the interests of your investors. You know, if you're someone who goes to a business school, one of the lessons you are taught at the heart of business is that you are supposed to, your primary concern is to guard the interests of your shareholders. And that is runs in the face of the very role that you have if you're supposed to be providing not just, you know, a place to lay your head, but actually providing for the care and well-being of asylum seekers, then I think that there is a conflict there between what are your major instigators.
One of your recommendations was for MERS to put a certain amount of money into a service that would look at mental health and well-being provision for asylum seekers and refugees. Mm-hmm. Has there been any movement on that at all?
Not at all.
No. Okay. Thank you. On that,
I mean, we had hoped that MERS would, of its own volition, decide that this was something that they ought to be doing, given what had happened. Many of the people who survived those incidents were still suffering the consequence of them. Mm. You know, the floors were awash with blood in that hotel where that crisis took place. And we thought that if MERS had any good sense and also wanted to maintain this contract, they should have immediately been funding, for example, the therapeutic help that should be offered to those people. And none of that was forthcoming.
Thank you. I'd like to bring in Maggie, please.
Thank you very much, CoCab. And good morning, Baroness. Thank you very much for joining us this morning. And thank you for the work you did on the inquiry. I think it's really, really important work. You talked in your opening remarks about the decisions relating to the Home Office and the UK government, but there was there was a very, very clear recommendation in your inquiry report that was for the Scottish Government to consider what powers we should be looking at here to mitigate the failings that have been identified, that the powers and support around the New Scots strategy, how that is resourced and governed, and then, of course, peer-to-peer support and how that is supported. Can you give us an indication of where you think the Scottish Government does have the powers to mitigate some of the decisions that are being made by the Home Office, given the current practice towards asylum seekers? And are there particular areas that you are particularly concerned about in the Scottish context?
Well, first of all, I wanted to say that I love the idea of New Scots, the concept that you embrace those who are going to be coming and you know, have the hope and aspiration of settling in your country because they're fleeing persecution. One of the things that became very clear to me, and I should mention this, was that a couple of years ago, when the evacuation from Afghanistan took place, the military evacuation took place, I was involved in the evacuation of a whole lot of women, judges and prosecutors and lawyers, human rights activists too, who were on the high level of security risk. They were the MI6 was very clear that they were on the kill lists of the Taliban, and so I was involved in evacuating them. And when it came to the business of trying to, I got them to Greece, to a lily pad. When it came to the business of saying, I need to find resettlement for this 103 women and their families, their husbands, who were good men, who were often, you know, professionals too, but who had got out, but who wanted their women to have professional jobs. They were not ones who wanted their women locked up at home and denied education. So they came with their children. They were in temporary accommodation in Greece, and I was trying to find places for them to go. Now, I spoke to the Scottish government, and the Scottish government was willing to take some of those women and to resettle those families. And of course, there was a detriment to that. There was a block on it because of the policy that was being adopted by the Home Office at Westminster. And so I think there is a thing there which is unfortunate about the, you know, protecting the borders of the United Kingdom. But with regard to the role that can be played by devolved government, there's no doubt that when it comes to the mental health and the physical health and the support systems, those are much better done. They're much better as a devolved matter. We know that when things directly affect the lives of people, that's much better within the devolved remit. And so we were very clear that we felt that, of course, money should come from central government to make that possible, but that should be handled by the agencies that are on the ground and understand the local circumstances and what is available locally and who are the people who are being supported and so on. They don't. Why would somewhere in Brighton have any sense of that? Why do call centres that are not based in Scotland know anything about that? So, I mean, we were very clear that when we met with people who did provide help in the ordinary circumstances, the social workers who were connected to the local authorities, we found that that was where real knowledge was and real support on the ground had taken place in the months before.
Thank you. That's really helpful. And that example I think you give is quite a powerful example. You spoke a moment ago about your position on some of the profiteering around the privatisation of these services. And can I just be clear, when you talk about the services that you feel should be better and would be better provided by local health, social care and other service providers, you're saying quite clearly that the funding for that should come from the UK government?
Oh absolutely. You know, if the policy is going to be run from the centre, then the centre has to take financial responsibility for things further down the road. And so I think money should follow the problem. What I think is wrong is the business that there's a profit-making element in this. There are many not-for-profit organisations that would do this very efficiently. I mean, you know, that we all know and have read the stories of, you know, those who were running those businesses that were to find accommodation for children in care and adolescents who needed housing and care and finding places for them, driving around in Maseratis and living the life of Riley. There's something absolutely repugnant in that when you're dealing with those in crisis, those who have got serious problems, and that profit should be made from such a thing. And so I personally have a very strong position on it.
Thank you. And you also spoke, I mean, the notion of new Scots, as you say, you find that a very positive idea.
I would
share that. I would agree with you. Do you think the new Scots strategy goes far enough? And resourcing notwithstanding, do you think there are other areas we should be looking at within the new Scots strategy?
I mean, if we look at the nature of the discourse that's taking place just now around asylum, I'm involved just now in the Westminster debates, and I've got amendments into this illegal migration bill. It's a shocking piece of legislation. I mean, it really, I say this, and I'm sure that there are members of your group who are members of the Conservative Party too. And I have many friends in the Conservative Party across the other side of the house from me, and they too feel a certain repugnance in it. One of them indeed said to me, it's the last card in the pack. Now, what is meant by a statement like that is that everybody knows that migration is one of those dog whistle issues, and unfortunately, as we approach elections, sometimes rather disgraceful decisions are made about what becomes important and what doesn't. And I'm afraid that the nature of the debates that are taking place just now around the illegal migration business and the business of crossing the channel is that the idea that we render everybody who comes by that route someone who is a criminal, who's illegal, and they don't get the opportunity of making their case for why they might be someone who is desperately fleeing persecution. They don't get the opportunity to do that, but they're criminalised, and that when they're deported, they're not going to ever be able to have the opportunity of coming here, even if they might have family already settled in this country, in the United Kingdom, in Scotland or in England or wherever. And so that is a breach of international law, mm-hmm. of the International Convention, which we partly were involved in drafting, and that included Scots lawyers, let me tell you. But it's shocking that the extent to which law is being thrust to one side in an effort to pursue a policy. And so I do want to just say that the nature of the debate around all of this has been horrifying, yeah. and the media don't help us. The media is, and so we have to try to create a different kind of discussion about why we do need immigration, but also why the business of asylum seeking is separate and different, yeah. and is about our duty of care to those fleeing persecution.
Thank you very much. I could go on, but I'll leave it there and let my colleagues come in. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Maggie. I've got a quick supplementary from Rachel, and then we will be moving to Paul O'Kane, who is joining us online today. Rachel, please.
Morning, Baroness Kennedy. Just to press you on the question that Maggie Chapman asked about the new Scots strategy, in the inquiry, your panel recommended that the new Scots strategy had more teeth. And you also talked about wielding the devolved powers of housing and health and social care. I wonder if I can press you on what you meant by giving the new Scots strategy more teeth.
Well, I mean, I really sort of mentioned it already. I do think that one of the ways in which, I mean, I think that is if you like, is the gold standard of what one should be doing across the United Kingdom, is saying that there is a welcome to people who come and want to settle here. And obviously, it's not an open door to the whole of the world. And when it comes to immigration, obviously one is going to be particularly interested in getting people who are going to bring certain kinds of skills that we perhaps just now don't have. And you can't overnight suddenly have all the doctors that our health service needs, and if you can't overnight deal with the technicians that we need for the sustaining of aircraft, for example. And so some of that recruitment is going to be necessary, and it involves being embracing. I sat for a while on the Justice and Home Affairs Committee in the House of Lords, and we did a report on family the entitlement to bring families together, family reunion. And we heard from senior doctors in the health service who wanted to bring their elderly mother from India because there's a strong a religious and cultural thing of looking after your elderly parents. And here was an older son, a successful consultant in Leeds, and he wanted his elderly mother to come, and the answer was no. And elderly parents, they don't want to have elderly parents reunion. Well, this is somebody who's giving his life to something that we care about in the firmament of British society. And it just seems ludicrous to us. And there were many examples of that, where the notion of family reunion is really not being fulfilled in many, many cases where it should be bringing brothers and sisters together. The whole discussion and debate around this is very poor. And I happen to think that the Home Office has been dysfunctional. We've seen it with all the scandals of Windrush, of the policies which were really about being hostile to any incoming people. And that's why I liked the idea that you're talking about new Scots, new Brits, whatever you want to call people. But in a sense that when you come, you're part of our society. And actually, by and large, we've been pretty good about all of this. Of course, we've not had, you know, it hasn't been perfect. There are times when there have been racist events. And in Scotland, too, where people have been seen to be, you know, taking housing away from the local population. But by and large, we have a good story to tell by comparison with other countries. And I think that we should be telling that story more often, and the media should be doing it. And the media often is complicit in a presentation of this as being a catastrophic problem, when the real problems are about the disaster around the economy and the way in which an effort was made during the period of austerity policies of diminishing government departments. You know, the numbers of people working on asylum, for example, inside the Home Office, greatly reduced. So that's why you got the backlog of cases that were still not resolved, because the number of people working on assessing asylum claims were far fewer, and there was a huge churn of those working in those areas. The turnover was very high. Why? Because there's a sort of moral jeopardy. If you're somebody who is having to decide on whether you think somebody's claim is justified, and you might think that it is, but you know that there's a sort of, if you like, a diktat coming from on high, which is that we have to be reducing the numbers of people who are getting in, and you've got to be tougher on this. There's a moral dilemma that people feel, and living with it is very hard. It becomes a conscience issue, and people don't. And so people were leaving the Home Office in droves. They didn't like doing the job. And of course, they're not very well rewarded for it, really. And it's a painful and difficult job, the material you're sifting and dealing with. So I think that the Home Office has been dysfunctional for quite some time, and it's going to take quite a bit of work to get it to a state where it is really handling these problems in a way that we would all, I think, probably want to see.
Thank you. Thank you, Paul O'Kane, please.
I'm very grateful, convener, and good morning to Baroness Kennedy. I wonder if I might return to the whole notion of hotels and the use of hotels. I think we've been particularly interested in speaking to all of our witnesses about their experience in hotels, and I suppose really focusing on the idea that a stay in a hotel should always be short term and transient. But I actually think what we've seen is it something that was intended to be a COVID innovation has actually become the norm. I wondered if you might say something about your work in terms of that piece, and essentially, is this becoming more and more normalised? And would you share the concerns the committee have heard on that and on the conditions within those hotels?
It most certainly is my experience that hotelling people has become normalised. It started off, as you've said, to be a short-term response to the needs of to find accommodation for people, and then of course COVID opened up a whole set of opportunities. And not surprisingly, hoteliers with fairly low-level kind of hotel provision found that actually here was a reliable way of making money. So they became different providers. I mean, we could call them something else and not call them hotels, because what they're really providing is sort of hostel accommodation. Because what happened in the hotels in Glasgow during COVID was that they don't go down in the morning and say, oh, I'd like brown toast and not white, and I'd like marmalade, and I'd like porridge, but bacon with my fried egg. But it's not like that. It was basically a hostel provision with a meal that, you know, like it or not, and the food was very cheaply provided and so on. And so we can take that as read. That was part of the report. But the business of hotel provision has now become normalised, because the people who ran those sort of low-level hotelling things for, you know, backpacking, cheap holiday people, either young coming to London or the young coming to Glasgow, that they found that here's a much more reliable source of income. You're not having to have the turnover. You're not having to sort of change the bed every night because somebody only stays one night. And so it became a much more profitable thing to people running that provision. So let's be very clear. This was done because it had financial benefits all around you. It's a cheaper way of doing things. People talk about the horror, and people up and down the country think they're staying in hotels, and we imagine what it must be like when we go and take our summer holidays. Let me tell you, it's not. And the hotels that are being used are of a very different order. So the hotel providers are really hostel provision. That's what it's like. And it's not even as good as what we provide, for example. It's not like student accommodation. It's hard, and it's hard for people with families, with children, when you're in a room in which you're sharing it with little ones. Really tough. But for people, even who are adults, very difficult. And during COVID, of course, it was particularly difficult when there was lockdown. But now still, I think that it's being presented to the general public in a way that's not honest. But I do think that you're right in describing it as being normal. I think there has been a normalising of it, and that is now. We can't pretend that there isn't a problem. You know, our young, leaving home, want to have somewhere to live, and the provision of housing has become a crisis in our country, and the ways to do that has become very problematic, and the investment in housing should be a priority for the nation, and that's not meaning just in relation to what you do for people who are asylum seeking. It's a problem for our young, it's a problem for people with young families, it's a problem for what you do with people as they become aged and you want to have sort of oversight of people. So we haven't got housing sorted in up and down the country and in England and Wales as well as in Scotland.
Thank you. I'm very grateful, Convener, for that response. And I think certainly that concurs with the evidence we have taken, and particularly the personal testimony of those who are living in hotels currently. I wonder if I might just touch on the support that is offered in those settings. I mean, certainly we have heard, and we've touched on this already in terms of Mir's input, that when we spoke directly to people living in hotels, they said that they felt the problems weren't resolved, that tensions grew, and perhaps as their own mental health suffered, actually things weren't resolved. No access to counselling, no access to kind of talking therapy, none of that. Mears, of course, when they came to committee, would contend that they were putting support into hotels and that they were providing that, if you have a problem, talk to us and we'll resolve it. But my sense certainly was that wasn't the reality on the ground. I wonder if you might just say something about that lack of support in hotels, particularly on the mental health issue.
Let me explain something that I felt in the inquiry, but I've come across in other sort of fact-finding activities. One of the problems is that people don't want people are anxious. They don't want to complain. They don't want to complain because they somehow imagine if you've come from a state where you were persecuted and where the powers that be were authoritarian, that you don't know. You know that Britain's supposed to be somewhere that is not like that, but you think that if you complain about the system, you might not get asylum. So that when you're even making contact with mayors or any, you don't know who all these people are. Are they employed by the state? Who are they? You're used to being often in countries where there are agents who are going to inform on you. So all the time, the voices in your head are saying, be very careful what you say here. It might be held against me, and I might be then, if I criticise anything, I might be told that I'm not going to get asylum. So there's that. There's the other thing, which is that people often wouldn't describe what they have as being mental health problems, because often countries that they're fleeing from, there's no mental health provision. They don't talk about mental health. It's not a way of thinking. It's something that we as a more sophisticated society perhaps know more about. And so you really have to take account of all of that. So Mears will say to you, Nobody mentioned to me that they were having mental health problems. And for example, in the hotel where this catastrophe happened, there were difficulties in other hotels too. But was that there was, you know, that people would come and sit in a desk in the area, you know, in the sort of reception area, and if you ever wanted to go and talk to them. They weren't people who were qualified in or had any skills in social work or in counselling or any of those sort of things. And there were guys who used to change the light bulbs in properties that mayors had run, when things went wrong. So, you know, you've got to have the right kind of capacity, the right kind of skills, and to understand that you have to sometimes be reading the runes with whether a person might have mental health problems. And sometimes people retreat, of course, into silence with their mental health problems rather than being talkative about them. So, you know, it's about the quality of provision, the nature of provision. But let me assure you, I did meet in the taking of evidence. I also met wonderful people involved in community support, people who themselves at one time had been seekers of asylum and were now settled in this country and had jobs, but gave their spare time to help people who were going through the same things themselves, and I was very impressed with and with local authority social workers that I met in taking evidence. So there are good people there who are trying to do good things, but I felt it wasn't, if you like, settled into the institutions that are involved in this and the corporate organisation that was involved in it.
Thank you.
I wonder. I mean, certainly we would recognise much of what you've said, and I think also echo your comments on the excellent support organisations we've met, certainly through the charitable sector and others, who often felt that sometimes there were barriers actually for them accessing the hotel because of many of the issues that you've mentioned. I wonder, finally, convener, if I may just ask a question in terms of the use of hotels making people more identifiable, I think, in terms of the risk of human trafficking and exploitation. And whether Baroness Kennedy feels that the use of hotels has actually created that the way we know where people are, therefore they become more of a target in that sense.
Absolutely. People know that people traffickers are not just sitting in, you know, they're not just operating in the north of France, and they're operating in our midst, and of course, if people are vulnerable. They can come to them, offer them the better accommodation, and it's a slow grooming of people into then the underworld that people can end up in. I don't know if you remember, but only about a month or so, or a couple of months ago, there was a scandal of something like 200 children have disappeared into the ether, who were received into the system. Were initially placed in hotels or something and have disappeared. We know for young people who are 14, 15, 16 to survive, they're going to be involved in issues to do with, you know, they'll be sexually exploited, they will be exploited for criminal activity and the like. And so, this is one of the serious problems here, is that we sometimes are failing to make the distinctions between adults and children. There is a fantasy out there that there are a whole lot of people who pretend to be children who aren't really children. I hear it being said, and I've heard it being said by people in Parliament. There are young men who sort of try to pretend that they're children and they've got, you know, 3 days growth on their chins. Well, sometimes people from certain parts of the world are more hirsute from adolescence than they are perhaps if they come from red-haired northern parts like we do in Scotland. But I'm telling you, the business of children in the system is still not being adequately addressed. And this new legislation does not comply with the Convention on the Rights of the Child. It doesn't comply with CEDAW, the Convention to Eliminate Discrimination Against Women, because pregnant women are going to be drawn into some of the horrors of it. And of course, the European Convention on Human Rights. But I would say that it contravenes our basic common law in that you're denying people the opportunity of due process. so that their cases are considered so that they can claim their entitlement to asylum and refuge and sanctuary because they're fleeing for their lives.
Thank you, Paul, and thank you, Baroness. I'd like to move on to Rachel Hamilton, please.
Baroness Kennedy, again, on the subject of trafficking and exploitation, in the report you said that we should be replacing institutional accommodation with community-based living arrangements. Now, in evidence, we've heard from many stakeholders, including mayors, that there is a lack of property, a lack of housing. And sticking on the subject of exploitation, in 2022, around 600 refugees were subjected to trafficking and exploitation. Of those, as you quite rightly said, 200 were children. Now, we are in a little bit of a stuck situation because of the situation with housing. So it's almost like we're in this cyclical nightmare where we cannot get out of the hotels. Even mayors are saying, you know, they don't have enough properties. What would your comments be around this situation to get the Scottish Government moving towards community-based integrated living arrangements?
Listen, I don't pretend that this is an easy one for governments, and there is a shortage of accommodation because successive governments have failed to build new adequate housing for young families and young couples and so on. So they end up being marooned in the little social housing that there is or in the places that they rent. And now increasingly that's becoming even more problematic, certainly in the south. I'm sure that the same sort of problems exist in Scotland. And so we have to have a building programme. And that in turn, I mean, what we don't want to see is let's build a whole lot of quick and easy places to build and put all the asylum seekers in them. We don't want the thing that they have in Paris, where you have environ, which are totally filled with people from other parts of the world, and you then create sort of silos of immigration. The integration success story is about people being, you know, living in our communities and in all different bits of our communities. And you know, you did hear wonderful stories of people living in accommodation. You know, what when I was young would have been called council housing, but you know, which is now you know, run by housing associations and the like, but people living and getting to know their neighbours and you know, sharing food and the asylum seeker cooking and then taking it to their neighbour as being something that they culturally were so used to doing, and that being so appreciated by Scots people. I mean, wonderful stories of, I mean, Scots who were neighbours of the people who were moved out of accommodation came and spoke to me at the hearing about why was this done? Why were they disrupted? They were living across the way, and he used to take my dog for a walk in the park because my hips are hurting me now. And my new neighbour was for the last year has been taking my dog out. So you know, there were that integration is what is so important, and I can't pretend that I have the answer to the immediate problem of how we deal with a shortage of accommodation. And I think there is a problem there. And the answer to it is about creating new housing across the piece for young people of all sorts, and having, you know, having a site to making sure that those communities, those new communities, new housing is varied and variegated and isn't just being a provision for new arrivals, for the new Scots. We mustn't have new Scots, new towns. You know, we can't have that. It must be that we provide that sort of integrated community thing. And but there are plenty of our own young who want to have housing that they can afford, and to provide places where they can bring up their children safely and happily. And it is a crisis of our times. Listen, you know, I'm afraid that I have a strong position on this, which is that, you know, taxes are what we pay to live in a civilised society. And I do think that provision of good housing is something that the state has to put its mind to. That you can't shrink the state to nothing. And that there are ideological views taken by some people that the state should be, you know, as minimal as possible, and everybody should be able to spend their own money the way they like. Well, I'm afraid there are some things that do involve policy making, sensible policy making, direction from, and inputs of money. And that has to come, and that has to be drawn from the business of taxation. So we have to have a much more honest conversation with the general public about this and about how we retain our reputation in the world for humanity, compassion, and also good sense.
Can I just clarify, Baroness Kennedy, in the inquiry, you did talk about mixed-sex accommodation within hotels. I'm trying to sort of link your thoughts on whether you believe that the integrated community accommodation would actually reduce the trafficking and exploitation. I don't have any detail on that, and I wondered whether it was something that was just a sort of a an aspiration, or whether there was definitely evidence to suggest that there was a link between having, you know, cultural integration and support from communities that then gave particularly women the support around them, so that they had, you know, people that were able to, I suppose, stop traffickers, if you see what I mean. So do you find any link?
I think that, Rachel, I think there is a link, because I think that we see it, I use France as an example. If you go to the banlieue where you know, is that everybody is from North Africa, the traffickers know where to go. You know, if people are integrated and there's much more variety, it's much harder. The business of being able to go in and source people who will be young drug carriers, act as mules, who will, or if you're doing it for sexual exploitation, your location is readily identifiable. People in hotels, readily identifiable. You know, Earl's Court in London is the place where all the hotels, the cheap hotels, are that are being used for migrants. So that makes the job of the trafficker so much easier. If people are spread around and are living in different communities and so on, it becomes much more complicated. Also, the support networks are there, and it becomes more difficult, and also people to go to. So, I mean, I just think that, you know, I think there has been a certain amount of research into this, particularly around modern-day slavery and trafficking. We were really generalists when it came to that, rather than people who were relying on those specific pieces of work. But I know from other, you know, over the years since the Modern Slavery Act came in, I've followed quite closely the problems that there are. And I do think that one of the success stories that we've had is in immigration has been about integration largely. And where you get people collected together in one area, you're more likely to get trafficking.
Thank you. I'd like to bring in Karen Adam, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Baroness Kennedy. your testimony this morning has certainly been very sobering, as your report was. I would like to ask, what has been the response from the Scottish and UK government in regards to the findings and recommendations within the report?
Well, I mean, when the report came out, the response of the Scottish government was very positive, and from the other parties in Scotland. You know, I received you know, communications from across the piece, welcoming the report and drawing attention to some of the serious problems that there are in this field. I've just now, for example, as a result of what I've learned, I mean, and I invoke it regularly when I stand on my feet in the House of Parliament in the Lords. I mean, over this illegal migration bill, I've regularly referred to the fact that I had the experience of being here in Scotland and hearing the evidence of people, seeing the good things that I think Scotland's been attempting to do, but also the problems that there are going to increasingly be with this piece of legislation that's currently been run through Parliament at a speed. I'm not hearing much welcome from the Home Office. The Home Office did not respond. and the Home Office and I'm the Home Secretary is not receptive to any kind of critique that does not fit with her worldview.
Thank you for that answer. It's certainly given us a lot of clarity over our investigations the last few weeks. We are looking, we know that here we don't have within our remit, you know, the reserve powers over immigration, but in regards to what we could do here in Scotland, do you feel that we are sufficiently addressing those issues or could we do more?
Well, I think that the resource is always gets back to this business. Resource is one of the problems. We have in Scotland, we have wonderful people working in the field of social, of social work, and we have wonderful volunteer sectors. I mean, you know, that's what one of the riches of Scottish society, and I think that could be drawn on more. But you still need resource. You can't, when people have mental health problems, of course, you need more people who are skilled in dealing with them. And that means skilling up more people in the provision of mental health support. It's more than just counselling. I mean, sometimes people are in need of, pharmaceuticals to deal with their depression and so on. And so you need doctors involved too, but all of this needs resource, and it's not just asylum seekers who've got mental health problems. The growth in the need for support post-COVID has been great, and our young across the whole of the United Kingdom are actually, the dearth of provision for the young is in the area of mental health is shocking. But all of that needs resource. And so you get back to the business. We're having an economic crisis, but we have to decide what has brought that about. And then you have to decide what the resolution is. And I'm afraid, if we're all going to be suffering the hardships and deprivations of a financial crisis, then I'd like to see some of the burden of that falling on the shoulders of those who still are still very wealthy.
Thank you.
And I would like to see... I would like to see that money coming into the system.
Thank you.
Thank you, Carden. Thank you, Baroness. I'd like to come to Fulton MacGregor, please.
Thank you, Baroness. Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Baroness Kennedy, for your very powerful session so far. And having, as a committee, met some asylum seekers recently who have expressed as the most horrific of circumstances, I think that if any of them or agencies supporting them are watching this today, they will be very welcoming of your strong words. So thanks for that. I mean, most of the areas have been covered, but one of the areas I wanted to go over again was when we've been speaking to people, it's almost always just the simple things. I think there's an understanding out there that there's wider policy and political influences that need to be sorted at that level, but for most of the folk we spoke to, they just wanted free transport, more appropriate meals, and treated with dignity and respect. So I know others have asked, but what can we do here and I suppose across the UK in terms of making this a reality for people?
We need more people working with this community. And some of those have to be people who for whom it's a paid job, and for others it can be volunteers. I think I may be romantic about us as Scots, but I happen to believe that Scots on the whole are very welcoming people. We had stories. I mean, there was a most wonderful story of two of the very, very black West Africans who were in the community and who were stabbed. Actually, both of them had been stabbed because they tried to restrain the guy and who had the knife, and they'd ended up themselves in hospital. Well, those two young men talked about how when they'd first been put into the hotels, they had been on the street and they'd been talking together about you know, what they were allowed to go out to walk, to do, remember, the hour walk, and they were going out to do the exercise. And there was a woman out, an elderly Scottish woman, and she said to them, how are you boys doing? And she fell into conversation with them. And then when they were able to associate, she had them to her home and fed them. And then they told the story of how she gave them a big pan of soup in a plastic container to take home with them. Good homemade Scottish soup. And they took it down and put it in the fridge in the kitchen. And when they went down in the morning, desperately looking forward to having this Scotch broth, it had been thrown down the sink, and because it was a foreign thing in the fridge, but I'm telling this about, not as a criticism of the hotel staff who didn't know it, but about the generosity of people in the community. And so, you know, on the one hand, I do think there is goodwill from Scots, and once people are in amongst them and they get to know them, they're very the kindness to strangers is great. The other thing is that there has to be the professional help, and it has to be resourced. And so I you know, it's about how, you know, it's robbing Peter to pay Paul. How you resource that? But I do think that we should be encouraging our, for example, I hope that one of your recommendations might be that we are providing more courses for people to acquire the skills of counselling, to recognise mental evidence of mental ill health, and that we, our universities and our further education colleges, our community colleges in Scotland are terrific, to be providing opportunities for people to skill up in the kind of provision that we need for the early, you know, for the stuff that falls short of florid mental health problems, where you really need it to be dealt with by, you know, doctors and psychiatrists and so on. But for some of this, it's about counselling and helping people to see why they're suffering grief. I mean, many of them are people, as you know, I say this in the House of Lords. How many people have actually spent time with asylum seekers? Because for the most part, they haven't. And you only have to sit and hear the stories of people watching their members of their family being slaughtered in the most terrible ways. It's happening in Sudan just now. The rape of women. I'm on the War Crimes Task Force for Ukraine just now. The abduction of children. The sexual violation of women in the presence of their family members. You know, in front of the grandparents of family, in front of the wee ones that there are in the household. I mean, and not just being raped, but raped over and over by whole groups of men. I mean, I can't begin to tell you, people, getting over that is terrible. And one of the things that we're going to be advising Ukraine about is having to skill up people to be able to deal with the aftermath of this. So, I mean, let's be clear that there are ways in which we can speak to all of our different institutions about roles that they can play. And I'm not sure that enough of our colleges are providing those kinds of training courses. And I think that there are people who volunteer who, for example, would be interested in acquiring additional skills so that they can do it even better.
Thanks very much, Baroness Kennedy, for that very thorough answer. But my next and final question is on and around Mears. And I know the convener said at the start that we did hear kind of mixed evidence on Mears, with the third sector organisations being particularly critical and local authorities and statutory organisations being a bit more supportive. We also had Mears in themselves. And what I wondered was, and it's possibly your opinion I'm looking for, that you what you maybe picked up through your work, do you think that Mears, because I don't suspect that Mears as individual people who are hearing the stories that we've heard wouldn't want to react and wouldn't want to be good, but do you think they've got the power to, or the green light to challenge the UK government, or do they live in fear of their contract?
What we didn't ever get to the bottom of, and it was partly because the Home Office refused to play, and refused to basically participate, where did the decision come from to move people from accommodation that they were in? I mean, there were some people who were, there was a woman and her son who were in a small flat that they'd been in for a couple of years, and who were moved. I mean, she had to then multiply the depression pills that she was taking because of what happened. And she ended up in a hotel room shared with her son, who was an adult. Of course, the people who worked for Mears were decent people too. So don't get me wrong, and full of kindness and so on, but often unskilled for the jobs that they were doing. But the other thing was, who made the decision that it was going to be cheaper to put people into hotels that were empty because the tourist trade had gone, therefore we've got another place where we can put people, and it's going to be much less expensive than putting people into places where rents have to be paid, right? Now, I think that came from the Home Office. Did Mears go to the Home Office saying, an alternative has come up, which is possible? But of course Mears didn't do it off its own bat. It came from the Home Office. And so decisions were being made, but nobody came forward to assist us in how was that decision made? Was it scoped? Did people think of the implications of it? Did they think of the consequences in terms of the welfare provision, the support systems that people might have established, the ways in which people's physical as well as their mental health might be catered for? Would there be enough people during a period of COVID to go and visit the hotels to see what the conditions were? And what, I mean, they wouldn't step forward to testify on any of that. But I suspect sitting down in London, and they were all working then individually from home, I think that this was done in the kind of rather chaotic way that the Home Office has been working for rather a long time. Now, it may be that there's now more effort going into dealing with the backlog of many people still waiting for decisions. They're going to have to deal with that anyway, and I think that they're getting in more staff and so forth to do it. But that decision was being made in the Home Office, but the Home Office refused, first of all, to hold its own inquiry. The people called for and the refugee support system was calling for a Home Office inquiry, a public inquiry, which was refused. And then when we held this inquiry and I asked the Home Office to participate, they didn't do so. So, transparency, accountability is fundamental in a democracy. And I'm afraid we've had less of that and more power going off to Home Secretaries to make decisions for which they're never held to account.
Thank you. Thank you, Baroness Helena Kennedy. You have provided us with very powerful, compelling evidence this morning as part of our inquiry. And I would like to thank you for taking the time to speak to us and give us all that information and insight. We are now drawing to a close to this part of the panel. And once again, thank you very much to Baroness Helena Kennedy for attending this morning.
You're welcome.
And I will suspend the meeting for just a short time while we change over to the second panel. I welcome to the meeting Emma Roddick, MSP, Minister for Equalities, Migration and Refugees and Supporting Officials, Alison Byrne, Interim Director of Equality, Inclusion and Human Rights, and Aileen Harding, Policy Manager, Asylum and Refugee Integration. And members have had a chance to look at the papers, and we will invite the Minister to make a brief opening statement before we open up to the committee for questions. Minister.
Thank you, Convener, for the introduction and for inviting me to be here to speak to the committee on what is, of course, World Refugee Day. And I will, following this meeting, be attending an event by the Scottish Refugee Council as part of Refugee Festival Scotland, which is in its 22nd year. There are over 120 events taking place across Scotland this week, coordinated by the Scottish Refugee Council, with this year's theme being Hope. And I recognise that both the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament have a crucial role to play in providing that hope to asylum seekers. The Home Office is, of course, responsible for UK asylum and immigration policy, including no recourse to public funds and restricting asylum seekers' right to work, operation of the UK asylum system, including decisions around how it operates, and provision of asylum accommodation and support. I do recognise that many essential services are devolved and a responsibility of the Scottish Government and local authorities, who play a key role in supporting asylum dispersal. I've also been amazed by the ongoing and constant efforts of Scottish third sector organisations in making an invaluable contribution to supporting asylum seekers in Scotland. We are proud to support those organisations, and the Scottish Government is providing nearly £1 million to third sector organisations in 2023-24 for refugee integration work. We've taken a human rights-based approach to our policy on asylum, with our new Scots refugee integration strategy being clear that integration should be supported from day one of arrival, and we're clear that that applies whether you first arrive as a refugee or a person seeking asylum. New Scots was developed and led in partnership by the Scottish Government, COSLA and the Scottish Refugee Council, and it helped Scotland secure £6 million from the EU's Asylum, Migration and Integration Fund, which went towards a £6.6 million project to support refugee integration. I am committed to working with our New Scots partners to refresh the strategy, building on work to date and ensuring that it continues to be informed by refugees, people seeking asylum and those with experience supporting both groups in our communities. The ambition of New Scots is the right one, to support everyone to have the best shot at integrating and being properly supported and able to realise their human rights. However, I do stress the difficulty in achieving that fully within the constraints of devolution. For example, we are providing over £1 million to support the delivery of our Ending Destitution Together strategy, which improves support for people with no recourse to public funds, including many asylum seekers. We do not believe that anyone should be pushed into destitution, but we have no power over who NRPF is applied to, nor can we support those with NRPF to access Scottish benefits or the Scottish Welfare Fund. The British Red Cross is a valued partner in delivering crisis funds to those who need it, inclusive of asylum seekers with NRPF, but it should not be necessary to resort to crisis funding to make sure someone is not made destitute. And Scottish ministers continue to raise issues and concerns about NRPF with the UK government. At this point, I would also like to make short mention of the Illegal Migration Bill and the Scottish Government's and Scottish Parliament's opposition to it. The Parliament, of course, debated and agreed a motion describing the bill as dehumanising and immoral. The bill is currently at its committee stage with the House of Lords, with a report expected in early July. The Scottish Government is clear that the bill will prevent people, including those being human trafficked, from accessing safety and support in Scotland, and we believe it should be withdrawn immediately by the UK Government. We know that trafficking victims are often suffering from severe trauma, that they have little choice about their movements and are frequently unaware of their location or how they entered a country. So removing existing protections based on how they entered the UK is irresponsible and indefensible. It will make victims much less likely to seek help, tightening the grip of perpetrators and therefore making the job of the Scottish Government in supporting victims of human trafficking, a duty that we take extremely seriously, very difficult. That is why we are seeking to withhold consent on key clauses which impact on the competence of Scottish ministers and our ability to operate in devolved areas. I will be attending an illegal migration bill summit on Thursday with some key stakeholders, and I would like to extend the offer, convener, to write to you following the summit to share any key insights. I will finish just now by highlighting our wider work through introducing a human rights bill and continuing to pressure the UK government for further powers to be devolved or at least improvements made to the immigration system, and setting out a vision for an independent Scotland that enshrines human rights in a written constitution. We are committed to doing whatever we can to help people who need it most. There is more to do, and there are significant challenges, which is why we are committed to working with our partners to refresh the New Scots strategy, building on work to date and continuing to ensure it is informed by lived experience, as well as organisations with expertise supporting people. I've been very interested in the important work carried out by the committee, and I look forward to hearing your questions.
Thank you. Thank you, Minister, for your opening statement. You will be aware that we had Baroness Helena Kennedy just prior to your appearance, and the recommendations that are in her inquiry. One such recommendations was the review of right to work, and I'm going to throw in sort of like free bus travel in there as well. So the right to work obviously not only makes economic benefit for Scotland, but also that human dignity of being able to provide for your family and not being a burden in any way. So what powers would the Scottish Government require for refugees and asylum seekers to be able to have the right to work? And are there any communications that are taking place or have taken place with the UK government around that issue?
Absolutely, convener. Those conversations are ongoing and have been long term. Certainly applying the right to work to asylum seekers is something that we have been particularly keen on, alongside removing NRPF, because these would allow integration as that set out in our vision, that allows people to integrate from day one and, as you say, be economically active during their time here. In terms of what powers we would need, that sits within the wider asylum and immigration power that the UK government holds. We have requested more power over the rights and entitlements of asylum seekers and other migrants. That is something that we will continue to pursue. In terms of bus travel, I would point out our approach has not been exclusive of asylum seekers. Our concessionary travel scheme as it stands allows for asylum seekers who meet the current criteria, including being under 22, over 60 or being disabled, to acquire free bus travel. That we estimate is around a third of asylum seekers in Scotland are currently eligible through that. I know there is a pilot ongoing that I will bring Aileen in to say a bit more about. But once we have further information about how that's being used by asylum seekers, what sort of journeys are being carried out, how much then it might cost for the Scottish Government to extend it, and what justification there could be for extending to one cohort rather than on the basis of age and disability, then we're more than happy to explore that and look into it further.
Yeah, that would be really helpful to get more information. It's been it has come up again time and time again through evidence, lived experience to third sector stakeholders. They've all raised the issue of free bus travel. So Aileen?
Yeah, so there is an existing programme for government commitment to look into how best to provide bus travel. Now, that could be concessionary travel, it could be through other routes, for example, through third sector schemes. There isn't a conclusion been made on that yet because the work is ongoing to explore that in line with the programme for government commitment. What's happening at the moment is there is a pilot running in Glasgow. Now, that builds on knowledge from third sector organisations who I know have given evidence to you, who have provided support themselves in the past, and we really appreciate the information they've been able to share with us on schemes they've run. The specific information we're looking to get from the current pilot is around how people use bus passes and how many journeys they make, those sorts of things, so that we can get more information on what the likely cost would be of either extending concessionary travel or otherwise providing. So there is evidence out there of need. We recognise that. That has been raised with us. What we're doing at the moment is running a pilot that we hope will provide more evidence on what the cost element may be to enable calculation to look at that. and to inform on how that benefits people seeking asylum so that we can use that to inform further consideration in line with the programme for government commitment. The pilot is running up to July. It's being run in Glasgow specifically because that's where most asylum seekers are currently, but we are also alive to the fact that widening dispersal is taking place, and therefore we also need to consider how best to provide bus travel across Scotland rather than just specifically in Glasgow.
Okay, Rachel?
Ms Harding, you've just actually answered in your last sentence. What I was going to ask is, there's a concentration, obviously, of asylum seekers in Glasgow, and do you think, does the Scottish Government believe that one of the reasons that local authorities are not taking asylum seekers is that they cannot get transport, so they're tending to seek areas that are cities that have an infrastructure in itself? And what is the Scottish Government doing about that beyond the issues with the challenges around bus travel?
I would just say, first of all, we are in the process of widening that asylum dispersal to other local authorities, but we have been really clear that given the amount of work that has gone in, and given the experience that has been built up, the experience and knowledge of those working in partnership in Glasgow to support asylum seekers, there's a lot of work that needs to be done to make sure that the support and the services are there once that dispersal is widened. So local authorities will have many different reasons and a variety depending on which council area is for having hesitation about accepting asylum seekers. But certainly, I think, in terms of transport, we will learn a lot from this pilot. And although it's very different, as you'll know, transport in a city to transport in a suburban or rural area, it will inform us on how much cost would be likely to be inflicted. And I'll bring Alison in just to say any more around asylum dispersal.
Thanks, Minister. Just to add to what the Minister said there, that one of the challenges for Scottish local authorities is the funding from the Home Office to support asylum dispersal, and that's only recently been put in place in the course of the last year. So that obviously allows local authorities to think differently about how they could support the wider dispersal of asylum seekers in Scotland.
Okay. Thank you. Can I just, the no recourse to public funds, and Minister, you mentioned that asylum seekers, refugees have different status that they're assessed on as well. In response to the Ukraine crisis and the war in Ukraine, the Scottish Government took on the role of super sponsor. Through evidence we have heard over the last few weeks of asylum seekers and refugees from countries such as Afghanistan, Eritrea, Sudan, who in no way wish to see, you know, the amazing work and the support that Scotland provided at both government level and public level towards the Ukrainians. However, they did feel that there was a disparity in treatment of different refugees from different countries. So I would just be interested to hear the Scottish Government's view on that, the Minister's view on that, and what would be the criteria in future, because unfortunately we do live in a turbulent world, of the Scottish Government using the super sponsor status again.
Yeah, I would point out, first of all, that Ukraine, the resettlement from Ukraine, was a reaction to a very difficult event, the illegal invasion of Ukraine. But we were led there by decisions made in the UK. So Ukrainians displaced in Scotland and the UK have a right to work. They have a right to access benefits. So they're in a very different position to how we would be able to treat asylum seekers from other areas or who had different routes in. This is one of the reasons that we've been really clear there need to be safe and legal routes. Because if you do not provide safe and legal routes, all that is left is unsafe and illegal routes. And I can completely understand why someone seeking asylum would look at the support that has been given to Ukrainians and wonder why has that not been extended to everyone else? But the unfortunate answer is that we do not have the ability to treat asylum seekers in the same way. And in terms of integration into the community, I know that it's been really successful in terms of Ukrainians who are displaced here at the moment being able to get into work. I think 85% of those in Edinburgh, for example, are in work. And they've been able to access services in Ukrainian due to the large cohort that have very similar needs and very similar background. So there are very different cohorts here that we are discussing, and we're simply not able to do things like how we reacted to Ukraine and Sudan in terms of expanding social security access to people with, for example, NRPF.
Thank you. Maggie?
Thanks very much, CoCab, and good morning, Minister. Thank you for being with us this morning. I'm interested in exploring some of the possibilities we have for action around the use of hotels. We know that hotels have been increasingly used not as the temporary or short-term accommodation that was originally intended, but really they've become institutionalised accommodation across the piece. And we see this not only in Glasgow, but in other parts of Scotland, like Falkirk, Aberdeen, for instance. Firstly, what do you think are the priorities for ensuring that we actually move people out of hotels as quickly as possible? Because we know that those aren't the best places for them to be. They don't necessarily, asylum seekers don't necessarily have the mental health and other healthcare support that they should. It also ghettoises, it makes them targets, it identifies them very clearly as that community of asylum seekers living in that one place. So what are the Scottish Government's priorities for ensuring that the institutionalised use of hotel accommodation shifts?
Well, I would say, first of all, I've been really interested in the evidence that the committee has gathered around hotels, but keeping in mind that the placement of asylum seekers in hotels or other temporary accommodation is a decision that's mm-hmm. wholly reserved to the UK. I think it's really important, again, to go back to my answer to the convener, to the previous question, asylum seekers not having a right to work, not having recourse to public funds, makes the placement of being in a hotel very different to how it would be for other cohorts. Mm-hmm. So we're clear that there is time to use hotels. There are appropriate circumstances. We don't see asylum seekers waiting for a decision on their immigration status as being an appropriate situation. And I completely agree around the use of the word temporary. If we are providing people with temporary accommodation, it needs to be clear that it is temporary. And with the waiting lengths for decisions around immigration status being what they are and the uncertainty that asylum seekers are facing, I don't think it's fair to use that word mm-hmm. When placing asylum seekers in hotels in Scotland.
Okay, so I mean, one of the challenges, and we heard from Baroness Kennedy this morning, is that local authorities and others are finding is not having the capacity to move people out of hotels because the accommodation isn't there. And I appreciate that provision of housing is something that is within the powers of the Scottish Government. I think there's also something around some of the health and social care support that is also directly, that's clearly devolved. So clearly within our capabilities. Is the Scottish Government thinking of working differently with local authorities and third sector partners to try and make sure that we whilst asylum seekers are in, I think, pretty horrendous hotel accommodation in that situation, they do actually get the best possible health, social care and other support that they need in that, as you say, so-called temporary situation?
I would say, first of all, it is the Home Office that is responsible for matching refugees into properties. In terms of health and social care support, the Scottish Government has always been clear that asylum seekers and refugees have access to NHS services. Mm-hmm. They can register with a GP. Same goes for other devolved services like education. A child seeking asylum or a child refugee has the right to an education as with anyone else. I would also go back to the matter of funding for local authorities. We have long highlighted that the UK government's asylum dispersal funding is inadequate. And having met with partners in COSLA and local authorities, that is definitely being felt at the moment. And there is a great deal of fear about increased asylum seeker provision without extra funding. So if the committee were minded to back our calls to the UK government to ask for further funding and further clarity around that, then that would be very welcome.
I think one of the things we heard very, very clearly from organisations supporting asylum seekers, from asylum seekers themselves, and actually from this morning's earlier panel, was the lack of that channel of funding to third sector organisations. There's a lot of money going to hotel providers and MIAs, and actually none going from the Home Office directly to third sector support organisations, which is just completely back to front in my view. There are other words I could use to describe it, but I won't. Just a couple of other points. One, when we've been speaking to asylum seekers, as we have done in the last couple of weeks in different situations, the joined upness of services has been an issue for some folk. We know that in addition to the public transport pilot you've already discussed in Aberdeen, one of the bus providers in Aberdeen did work with GREC, the Grampian Regional Equalities Council, and got a bus service provision for asylum seekers going there. And these are so important for allowing people, nobody wants to sit in a hotel room for most of the day, leaving to go and eat food that may or may not be culturally sensitive, maybe being able to get out to go for a walk to nearby facilities. But if they're having to travel further afield, there's a mental health consequence of not having these additional services that may not seem like life or death, but actually are fundamental to being human. And I just wondered, What more the Scottish Government, either through the new Scots strategy or the Ending Destitution Together strategy, we can look at to ensure that we look at the whole. We don't look at services in silos and say, right, you get your health care from the GP, you get your housing when that is worked out with the Home Office and the local authority, but we actually look at asylum seekers as human beings in the whole. And I'm just interested to know what more you think we could be doing in that space within the powers we have.
I completely appreciate the points made, particularly around mental health impact and the support around that. We are working with a Glasgow-based mental wellbeing project to support better those who are facing these challenges. In terms of third sector funding, as I said in my opening statement, we have provided over £2 million between the two different funding streams that the member mentions. Now, much of that from the Ending Destitution Together strategy goes to the British Red Cross to provide crisis grants to those at risk of destitution, but we have to be clear they are at risk of destitution due to NRPF, not having a right to work, difficulty getting appropriate housing. So it's very difficult to carry on funding at these levels to mitigate what are essentially failures in the UK government's immigration system when that is not something that we are allowed to change. But we do have that duty to try and make things better around the edges. So I would much rather be making big changes to the rights and entitlements of asylum seekers. I would much rather be saying, yes, we will remove NRPF. We will give people the right to work. But as we can't do that, what we are left with is providing crisis grants and other support through different means.
Okay. Final question, a quick question. Oh, well, actually, maybe it's more of a point to flag. One of the things that we heard speaking directly to asylum seekers in the last couple of weeks as well was when their status changes, when they do get a decision and they become refugees, it's almost like they dropped. you know, there are some support networks that exist within the hotel structures, or they've built up relationships with organisations, and when they get their settled status or refugee status, they can't access that anymore because they're no longer asylum seekers. And I think there's just something for us to watch there, that we, in that transition from asylum seeker to refugee, we don't have people falling through the cracks and therefore being even more in need of the kind of crisis funding you were talking about.
Yeah, I think, and I hope the member understands kind of the reason that resources are pushed towards asylum seekers, because obviously in international law there's no distinction made, yes. But in terms of rights and entitlements in the UK there is that distinction, yeah. And the difficulty then is that we've got people who are being forced into destitution, and that's where limited money has to go. But I think absolutely in terms of developing the refreshed New Scots strategy, this is the kind of thing that it's really important to pick up on.
Okay, thank you. I'll leave it there.
Thank you. I'd like to bring in Paul O'Kane, please, who is joining us online.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to the Minister and officials. I'm keen to explore further, if we can, the Scottish Government's response to the Illegal Migration Bill with the UK Government. I wonder if the Minister would just share with us what interactions she has had in terms of the bill with the UK Government, and what representations have been made and with whom.
I think I've picked up enough there, Convener, if you want me to...
Yeah, I think the general thrust of that was regarding the Illegal Migration Bill and what communications have you had and who with?
Yes. So, of course, we did have the debate in Parliament, which informed our way forward. The Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice wrote to Robert Jenrick to reiterate the Scottish Government's opposition to the bill on the 25th of April. And then, of course, we led the political debate in opposition of the bill's provisions in the Scottish Parliament. On the 30th of May, we lodged our legislative consent memorandum with the Scottish Parliament. And there will be an opportunity to discuss that in a parliamentary debate. That LCM recommends that consent should not be given to clauses 23 and 27, which are the clauses I referenced in my opening statement, which we believe significantly alter the competence of Scottish ministers and our ability to meet our international human rights obligations to support victims of human trafficking, including children. The discussions have been ongoing both between officials and ministers with those in the UK government to make clear what we are opposing and why. So that's been ongoing, and I'll pass to Aileen as well, just to...
I was just going to say, so the Scottish Government, just to be clear, has lodged that LCM on the 30th of May. It is going through the process to determine whether it's considered to be a relevant bill by the Parliament for there to then be debate on that. So the view of the Scottish Government is that it is, but it does have to go through those parliamentary processes to be accepted before there can be debate scheduled on that.
All okay?
Thank you, Convener. I'll just check you can hear me. I think the previous question, there was an issue.
I can hear you. You're just, you cut out periodically, but very briefly.
Of course. I wonder then, given the context, if we might hear from the government in terms of what's been done in the devolved context. Obviously, the human trafficking legislation that was brought in 2015 is an area where we would seek to challenge much of what we've been talking about in this inquiry. I just wonder if the minister might say something about progress on that.
Yes, certainly. The Act was, of course, passed in 2015 unanimously by the Scottish Parliament, which I think shows the strength of feeling across all parties around doing more to support victims of human trafficking. Police Scotland are continuing to work closely with UK partners and beyond to share that intelligence and coordinate work. So we are bringing in as much knowledge and expertise as possible so that we're able to approach it as widely as possible and as effectively as possible. But we are very concerned that should the bill pass in its current form, we would be severely limited in how we'd be able to identify and then support victims, because they would have that extra burden of not being able to come forward and explain their situation due to the potential removal from the UK.
Thank you. I'd like to go to Rachel Hamilton, please.
Thank you, Convener. Minister, I was wanting to ask you how many Ukrainians are still living on cruise ships in Scotland?
I don't have the exact number to hand. I think just to give a bit of context here, the number is changing every day at the moment because the disembarkation of the MS Victoria is getting to its near final stages. So every single day we're seeing quite a significant number move off the ship. But I don't know if officials have our most
up-to-date. Well, whilst
you're
looking, where will the Ukrainian refugees be moved to?
So the full variety of accommodation that Ukrainians are currently living in Scotland is being used as options from the ship. And we've had significant interaction with the private rented sector around what offerings there are, particularly in Edinburgh. We have had Ukrainians matched with host families across Scotland, and there have been specific movements, particularly around the 50 million that was provided to, well, made available to local authorities to upgrade empty and void properties. So when those have been coming online, Ukrainians on board have also been matched with those new properties that we've managed to bring back into use. I don't think we've managed to get a specific number, but we can definitely write back with the most up-to-date statistics.
Who pays for the accommodation? You just mentioned there was a £50 million fund. Is that part of the Ukraine Longer Resettlement Fund?
So this was the specific funding that was made available for local authorities to use for only empty and void properties. Of course, once Ukrainians move out of those properties, they will then be available for social use again by the local authorities.
Is it temporary? Is that what you're saying?
Well, it's temporary in that most Ukrainians living here consider any place that they're living temporary, but it is not temporary accommodation in the way that hotels and vessels are.
Yeah, I would. I mean, thank you very much for offering to get back to the committee with regards to the number that have moved off the cruise ships. But it would be interesting to know how many had moved, as you described, to a variety of accommodation, whether it was hotel or to private rental or to social housing. But I'm interested in the number of houses that are becoming available within local authority settings for those asylum seekers who have got settled refugee status and those who are Ukrainian refugees. How is there parity over the offering of housing to move individuals from hotels or cruise ships to accommodation?
Well, firstly, in terms of the statistics around where Ukrainians are moving to from the ship, that is something that due to the context of them all being on the vessel, that is something that we have managed to collect extensively data on where people are going and why. And it's a lot easier to do actually when they are based first on the ship and with all that support service around them. So those statistics are being collected, and we've had quite a good insight into future planning in terms of how many want to go to Ukraine in the near future and how many are thinking much further ahead or want to leave Ukraine altogether permanently. Sorry, I've forgotten your second question.
Well, it's just on the parity.
I would point out that the super sponsor status that we have in terms of Ukraine is a unique situation. So there isn't parity because the Scottish Government does not have that formal role in other immigration routes. So we would if we had the powers that we've been asking for around being able to set our own controls over immigration and our own rights and entitlements for those seeking asylum or for refugees, but we do not. I think the many successes of the Ukraine super sponsor scheme in terms of the support that was offered to those who arrived here under it and the partnership working with COSLA and local authorities and third sector partners is a demonstration of what can be done if we do take that approach of treating people with dignity and respect and allowing them the right to work. Making sure that there is varied types of accommodation available to them based on their needs. And I think having seen the working between different local authorities, we had councils from across Scotland coming to be on the ship and speak to those living there about what was on offer in their area. That's a great demonstration of what can be done if we do take that human rights-based approach.
Can I just ask about the new Scots strategy, which has been covered by, I think it was Paul O'Kane asked a question there. But there's been some debate about how it's working because it seems to be an umbrella term for a lot of different groups of people. So, for example, this committee hasn't specifically had the opportunity to speak to any Hong Kongers. However, we know that across the UK, around 166,000 Hong Kongers have come to this country, but a very, very small number have come to Edinburgh, so just a few hundred. I'm interested to know if the Scottish Government have done any analysis on why there are so few Hong Kongers wanting to come and live and work and stay in Scotland.
So there's always ongoing information coming through, and I had a really interesting discussion actually through Reform Scotland quite recently about Hong Kongers and the roots and why people are moving where they are, and it very much seems to be based around where there's particular information or an existing diaspora saying this is what works, this is where works for us. And we find that with cohorts that are in Scotland and are continuing to move to Scotland, is it's those who came from the same country, who they know their families, living in a particular place, draw them there.
Yes, I would agree. I mean, looking at the statistics, it shows that a lot of Hong Kongers have settled in Manchester and Salford, and that those sort of areas in the northwest. However, Hong Kongers who have come here, who are just a few hundred, recently had a round table, and they felt... they didn't feel welcome, and I think that it is important for us to understand how the impact of them choosing to come to Scotland has had on them, and it would be welcome for the Scottish Government to do some analysis around that. To my comment that the new Scots strategy is perhaps an umbrella term rather than looking specifically at cultural identities and understanding people, for whom they are, rather than because they have, are part of a group of people who have been displaced.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think it's important to keep remembering that, even though it's an umbrella term for all different groups of migrants, even within, refugees, asylum seekers, these are not homogenous groups and they do have different needs and different expectations upon arriving in Scotland. In terms of Hong Kongers in particular, this is the kind of lived experience that's going to be really valuable when we're shaping the refresh strategy, so we can absolutely engage with the people who've raised these concerns as we form the new strategy and make sure that these things are taken into account, and hopefully they will feel that the next strategy is much more relevant to them if they've managed to feed in during that process.
Convina, I had a question about ESOL, which was part of this. Do you want me to ask that?
Yes, go ahead.
So it was just really, as part of that welcoming strategy, we heard in evidence from various stakeholders that the access to ESOL is very challenging, and I wondered what solutions the Scottish Government were proposing to address that.
Yeah, it certainly is very challenging, and I'm aware that the displaced people from Ukraine at the moment, the demand for ESOL is creating a lot of pressure on providers and increasing waiting times, and we are looking at ways to support that to move on. Again, I would kind of point out that, you know, this is one of the funding issues that comes with asylum dispersal that is not specifically funded by the UK government. So we're in this position where we don't have control over which ESOL is needed, how much is needed, but then we still have to provide it. So there are all these challenges going on around where the funding comes from.
That's interesting, actually, because I think it's something our committee should dig deeper into with regards to what kind of ESOL is required. I'm not quite sure what you mean. I met a Ukrainian refugee the other day who said that she was funding her own ESOL privately and taking, you know, virtual lessons so that she could ensure that she could get work in Scotland. And I'm wondering what you're meaning by that requirement.
So at the moment, what's happening is colleges are working with community planning partnerships, because based on the local area, there will be different need and there will be different demands. So online is a good example of that. There are certain settings where it's very difficult to get people around in a room, but there are also examples going on of things like language cafes, which seem to work a lot better for certain people, not everyone, because it's a relaxed setting and it's more conversational and it's more informal, and people are, well, some people are more able to pick up a language in that kind of setting. So there are different kinds of provision of ESOL, and that's why it's really important to us that local communities are able to feed into that and design it based on what the local need is, particularly if we're looking at kind of rural challenges where people might prefer online to travelling, or they might not be able to access online.
Okay.
Thank you. I'd like to move on to Karen Adam, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister. I'd like to ask you a few questions in regards to what we can do here in Scotland that is within our competence. We've heard over the last few weeks, given witness testimonies, of a few areas which are obviously within the remit of the UK government. And Baroness Kennedy told us this morning that there were issues with the Home Office. But the Scottish government and local governments do have some competence in some areas. Are there any areas you feel that could be used within our competence to address some of the issues of asylum seekers in Scotland, which we're maybe not currently doing?
Well, I think in terms of what we can do, we are doing what we can in terms of supporting asylum seekers, not excluding people, which we have seen be the attitude in other settings. We are inclusive, so the public services in Scotland, like the NHS, like schools, the baby box as well. Asylum seekers can receive the baby box, can access these services. And the member will have seen just yesterday, we did publish our vision for what a constitution of an independent Scotland could look like. And that enshrined human rights for everyone in a written constitution. And that's the approach that we're trying to take even now as a devolved government. In our human rights bill, which is out for consultation at the moment, we are seeking views on how we can best incorporate international treaties as far as possible within devolved competence into Scots law, because we would not seek to treat people differently based on how they got here or what their personal circumstances are. So I think embedding that approach, that's taking a lot of work at the moment across government, because it needs to be something that all ministers have in mind, that we're taking this human rights-based approach, that we are embedding equality in all that we do. But for all devolved services that we're providing, there's not a gatekeeping there preventing asylum seekers from accessing the baby box, education, the NHS.
It's really good to hear. Thank you. And I do note that the Scottish Government is extending tuition fee support from August this year to asylum seeking children, and also there's a guardianship system that's coming into place as well. Could you give us a brief outline of what that would look like and how that's going to help our asylum seeking children?
Absolutely, and before I bring an official in, I'll just say that is one of many examples, because we are also making sure that the progress made around childcare and early learning is expanded to asylum seekers as well. And this is all going back to the principles of our New Scots strategy, that integration from day one is absolutely the goal. So that's why we expand as much as we can rights and services to asylum seekers, and we are looking to do more every day. We are asking the UK government to, for example, remove the Scottish Welfare Fund from one of the excluded benefits under NRPF. We are pushing for whatever we can to expand provision to asylum seekers, but I will bring in Aileen to say a bit more about the tuition fees.
Yes, so the tuition fee specifically is going to enable from this year and this academic year for young asylum seekers who have made their asylum application before they turned 18 to continue their learner journey. So they will be able to progress from school if they're offered a place at university, be able to apply for their tuition fees in the same way as any other student would do, and therefore not have that artificial break in continuing their education while they wait for a decision from the Home Office. Once someone has refugee status, they can apply to SAS in the same way, the same sort of eligibility as other students who are resident in Scotland. So this will extend that specifically. I am aware from colleagues that they are also looking at the outcome of consultation that was taken forward earlier this year around access to education. So they will be looking at this further, and that may include consideration for other groups of asylum seekers or other groups who currently can't access and won't benefit from the change that is coming in. But it is a real benefit to young asylum seekers that they won't have that artificial break whilst they're waiting for a decision, and will be able to continue with their peers into education.
That's fantastic to hear, because we know that from witness testimony from asylum seekers that the uncertainty was something that really affected their mental health, so avoiding any such breaks is particularly important. Can I ask about the guardianship programme and what that looks like?
Yeah, so the guardianship service is actually a service that has been running for some time, I believe since 2010, on a non-statutory basis. The significant change is that that is now coming in on a statutory basis as of the 1st of April this year. So the service will be providing specialist support to unaccompanied asylum seekers and trafficked children who arrive in Scotland. So children are looked after children. The benefit really of the guardianship service is working with the child, having somebody who can advocate with them, who can ensure that they're aware of the services that they can access, and if there are barriers to access, support them in that access to them.
That's very helpful. Thank you.
Thank you. Could I bring in Fulton McGregor, please?
Thanks, Convener, and good morning just to the Minister and your officials. Thanks for your evidence thus far. I've got a few areas of questioning, if that's all right. And the first is on mother and baby units. When we met with asylum seekers over the last couple of weeks, we've had some in private, we've had some very powerful sessions, and I think my colleagues have already went over some of the issues that have been raised. But the session 2 weeks ago, mother and baby units were talked about quite a lot, and one of the particular groups that I remember being on, there was some quite horrific stories to hear about that. So I'm just wondering if the Scottish Government have made representation to mayors or the Home Office regarding the use of mother and baby units, and what the Scottish Government is doing to make sure that asylum-seeking mothers with babies are being supported. And the concerns that we heard were around in Glasgow.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm aware of the concerns that the member raises. Of course, the accommodation in Glasgow stopped being used as a mother and baby unit last year. The Scottish Government did make representations back in 2021 It was before the election, so it was Aileen Campbell was the Cabinet Secretary, but those representations were made and we have been clear that, that there are concerns around that provision and how safe and secure it was for those who were being placed there.
Yeah, that's good to hear, and I think it will be welcome news to those women that spoke to us that day to hear the Scottish Government responding so categorically in that. Similarly, we heard quite a lot, and we've heard it right throughout our whole evidence session here about the provision of interpreters. You're probably aware of this, Minister, and you know, we've heard quite a lot of concerns about inconsistencies in the provision of interpreters and also the quality of them. One of the things that we've heard quite a lot of asylum seekers tell us is that sometimes interpreters don't actually say what it was that the person said. Are you aware of these concerns, Minister, and what do you think the Scottish Government can do more to address them?
So, again, it's the Home Office that holds overall responsibility for the delivering of interpretation and translation services. But asylum seekers living in Scotland have the same access rights to interpretation as refugees do. It is provided at the point of need, so I appreciate there will be differences because funding is sourced in all these different ways, but I'm more than happy to look more closely at the evidence the committee has gathered.
Oh, thanks very much on that, and I think that when we do produce a report, it will be something that will be highlighted because of the amount of evidence that we heard on it from both organisations and individuals. Moving on to my second line of question, Convener, if that's all right, was around about mayors. Obviously, we've heard varying evidence on mayors. Broadly speaking, third sector organisations fairly critical of the mayors' service provided. Mayors themselves, perhaps unsurprisingly, and statutory services like local authorities being more positive. I'm just wondering what the government's understanding is of the relationship that MERS has with statutory agencies and community organisations, and if there's regular meetings between the government and MERS, and if there's MDLs involved in those.
So I would say there has been some engagement with MERS group in the past, but of course the member will appreciate that the Scottish Government doesn't have a place in the contract between the UK Government and MERS Group. It is entirely between them. The UK Government sets the criteria for the contract and then MERS delivers it. But the committee would certainly have a place in scrutinising how that relationship is working and whether the contract is meeting expectations. I will bring Aileen in just to say any more about official engagement.
Yes, so Scottish Government at an official level does have discussion that includes MERS. It's not direct discussion with MERS as an individual organisation. It takes place through the asylum structures in Scotland. So there are regular meetings of the Asylum Partnership Board, which is chaired by Suzanne Miller, who I know gave evidence to the committee from Glasgow Health and Social Care Partnership, and also at an operational level in the Delivery and Procurement Group, which is chaired by COSLA. So Scottish Government officials engage in those, MERS engage in them, Migrant Help engage in them, as do local authorities in particular, and that's looking particularly at asylum dispersal. So we engage with MERS through those meetings. I am aware, but I'm not directly involved in meetings that MERS do have with third sector, that they do meet with a third sector group, but more detail of that you would have to seek from MERS directly.
Thanks for that. And in those meetings that you described there, does the Scottish Government, I appreciate that obviously the contracts with the UK Government, does the Scottish Government get an opportunity to raise some of the concerns that we've heard about MERS, or you know, is there an opportunity there to discuss how they operate in Scotland at those meetings?
So those meetings, if there are concerns that are being raised with ourselves and equally with local authorities, it does provide a space that enables us to raise those and ask MERS and Migrant Help. Now, that participation and engagement is one of the reasons that it's enabling discussion about widening dispersal and things like that to take place in Scotland. So as has been said, the contract and the terms of what they have to deliver do still sit between the Home Office and the contractor, but it is helpful particularly for trying to ensure that there aren't unintended barriers to access to services and things like that, that there are operational level discussions in the dispersal space in Scotland. And we are encouraging particularly that the Home Office recognises those structures and engages with those structures on any plans around asylum dispersal in Scotland.
Okay, thanks very much for that. And a very final question, which will be very brief, convener. The Minister mentioned there in her response to Karen Adam about the recent paper this week, I think just yesterday actually, on independence and a constitution for Scotland and the protection of rights. I wonder if the Minister would be able to outline how she thinks such a constitution will impact directly asylum seekers in Scotland who, as we've all heard, are being treated in the most appalling of circumstances by the current UK government regime.
So I would say first of all, human rights being enshrined in Scots law will benefit absolutely everyone. But asylum seekers are a particularly good example of the real life impact of both having those rights realised in a country and being able to access justice if those rights were not being met. So in terms of being able to be supported by the government, having a right to access housing, a right to access education, all of these things have real impact on the lives of everyone. But when we look at asylum seekers as a cohort now in Scotland, we do see that there are areas where human rights in the treaties that we are looking to incorporate are not being met in those groups. So having those absolutely set out and, of course, sticking to them and making sure that everything we do when we're assigning budgets, when we are making decisions on policy, that we have human rights in mind, that we are prioritising based on meeting the human rights of everyone in the country, that absolutely has real life impact.
Excellent, thank you.
Rachel Hamilton had a supplementary.
Just a point of clarity, just on the, you mentioned twice there about the devolve responsibilities for ESIL. Now, you said also that that asylum seekers have a right to education. Is that delivered through Education Scotland, ESIL?
ESIL has been integrated with the adult learning strategy, so it is delivered by colleges, but in partnership with community planning partnerships, just to make sure that there is that local engagement and local tailoring.
I just wanted to clarify what you said earlier with regards to the Home Office being responsible for ESIL.
So what I said was that asylum dispersal funding should meet all the services that are then required to be provided by the Scottish Government or local authorities.
But that is part of the right to education, the learning English language.
Right, but I'm speaking here about the impact on services of having asylum seekers in a particular area. So that does come with specific needs that are reserved matters, but it also impacts on devolved services. So asylum dispersal funding needs to make sure it is meeting that extra cost and service provision that is needed.
No, I'm still not understanding what the difference is.
I think perhaps we're coming to the end of our session, and I'm sure that the Minister would be more than happy to answer any further questions from the committee that are put in writing, and then
Absolutely.
We have clarity around sort of phraseology and understanding. I'm sure you'd be happy to do that, Minister.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely. And on that level, we have come to the end of this session. The time has gone very quickly. This is, in fact, the final sort of live session, as it were, regarding our inquiry. And I would like to thank the Minister for attending and for her officials this morning. We heard from Baroness Kennedy this morning, but throughout the last few weeks, we have heard from a wide variety of stakeholders that are doing amazing work up and down the country. We've also heard from local authorities, from mayors, and we have had many written testimonies that have been put in. We also undertook two sessions in private where we went out into the communities and spoke to asylum seekers and refugees and heard their voices directly from them, which was invaluable, I think, in seeing the person and not just talking about the abstract. We will now be moving on to sort of like putting all of that together, the challenge of putting all that together and working on creating a report over the summer. We did ask the UK government to take part in our inquiry, and unfortunately there was no response that was received from the UK government. So I would like to say that our inquiry has been comprehensive, but due to the lack of response from the UK government, it isn't comprehensive. However, I do feel that we have captured extensive voices across all of the themes that concern asylum seekers and refugees. And on that note, once again, thank you, Minister, and your officials for attending, and I draw this meeting to a close.